Good morning, and thank you for joining us for our worship experience. And we're going to be praying that the Spirit is with us, and that the Lord speaks to our hearts, and that together we are unified as the body of Christ. I just want to commend you for your generosity over the last few weeks, especially. I had made mention that the pastor's emergency fund has been fully active, and even let you know that it was getting a little bit low. And over the last 2 weeks, we've had many members who have given gifts for that fund, and that fund is back up strong where it should be, and looking forward to being able to minister to many people in our community. And so I want to thank you for your hearts of care for our community at this time in doing that. And we have been saying for the last 3 weeks, if there was ever a time that our community needed a missional church family, it is now. And your gifts and your contributions to the food drive, all of your support, back that up and show that we are all in on being a missional church family. You know, a missional church family believes in caring for, serving, reaching out to others, leading the way, and having a God-centered vision for the future. And we are in a five-week series, and this is what we've been talking about, is our identity as a church family. And what we have been learning over the course of these last few weeks and going to for the next 2 weeks after today is that when we come together as a missional church family, when we contribute our gifts and our service and our presence and our prayers, our church together, we are able to do incredible things. And this makes me think that, you know, as a church, when we are coming together and we're asking for increased commitments, that this isn't about what we can get from you, but this is what we can do together. And the more that we commit to the mission of this church, the greater impact our mission has in our community. Last week, I shared with you that we are in the midst of our stewardship campaign, and we put together a simple chart to answer the question, if I give a dollar to the church, where does it go? And this chart shows you who we are as a missional church family. It shows you what areas and what percentages of money go to those areas. And I want you to see that this is really a balanced approach to ministry. We have been striving for this. We've been working towards this for quite some time. And as we look at this chart affirms the direction of our church. This chart affirms our commitment. And this chart also shows you that our church is doing everything as strategically as possible to maximize every dollar so that we can continue to be a missional church family. Now, when you look at our stewardship campaign, you will see on an email, or you'll get through snail mail, you'll get the commitment card. And the one thing I love about our commitment card is it is not just a financial commitment card. On that commitment card, we're asking, will you increase your prayers for our church? Will you increase your presence? Meaning, will you be present in worship, and will you participate in the mission of our church? It then does say, you know, will you contribute gifts? All that God has given to you, will you contribute a percentage of that back to His church so that His church can pursue and be faithful to carrying out His mission? And then there's the service, and we're asking, you know, are you willing to increase your commitment to serve in our church this year? And so I love that commitment card because it is not a financial card. It is a journey of discipleship. And our commitment cards focus on us growing closer to Christ and His church. And so I encourage you, as you got that email, if you get it in the mail, really look at that commitment card and say, this is who I am as a follower of Christ. And yes, I'm going to say yes to these things because I want to continue to be a stronger disciple of Jesus Christ. And so you'll see it there, that slide of increasing our commitments. And we're praying for you. Leaders in the church are praying together. The staff is praying that God will work through our stewardship campaign so that we can have full confidence that this following year is going to be one of our best years ever. Here you're going to see that there are multiple ways to give to our church, and our website is a wonderful platform to visit. And you can go there and you can find out how to do some online giving, and we have multiple options. And so please, we encourage you, the less paper that we use, the better for us. And so thank you so much for your faithfulness. And we are going to continue to have for this year a Forward by Faith Spirit. I ask at this time if you'll join me in prayer as we prepare our hearts and our minds for the teaching that will be coming from God's Word. Dear Lord, you have instructed us that the two greatest commandments are to love one another and our Heavenly Father. In this sacred time together, we invite your Holy Spirit to speak to, shape, and move our hearts to live into Christ's instruction. Amen. Well, as I mentioned earlier, we are into the third week of our five-week series on being a missional church family. And I'm so excited about today's lesson because I believe it's going to really speak to our hearts. It's going to really apply to our world today, and it's going to give us an incredible, inspiring challenge to go forward after we receive today's lesson. Today's lesson just begins with Jesus, and Jesus was missional. And one of my favorite stories of Jesus being missional is in the book of Luke, chapter 19, verses 1 through 9. It's a story you're familiar with, but it is one that is very helpful for us to regularly revisit and to learn from again anew. It says that in that passage that Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up to him and said, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." Now, we love this story. In Sunday school, we had a song about Zacchaeus up in the sycamore fig tree, and you know it well if you grew up at that time. But, you know, as we come back to this familiar text, there are some things that we can't help but notice. So when we look at this account, the interesting thing is that Zacchaeus sees the excitement. He sees people rushing to the streets. The word is out. And the text says that Zacchaeus sees all the excitement. He sees the movement of people to a street, and he wants to know what's going on. Now, he'll receive a word that a special guest, a special teacher, a miracle worker, a healer is coming to Jericho that day. And Zacchaeus will catch a snippet of this man's name being Jesus. And so Zacchaeus is interested in, who is this Jesus and what is he about? Now, the wonderful thing about this story is that as Jesus makes his way to Jericho, a little background is going to be that in Jericho, before Jesus arrives, quite some time beforehand, a small group of believers in Jesus were together. They were probably a small group or a cell church, and they were following Jesus. And what happens in Jericho is that this small group of believers, they begin to share their faith. They begin to share their excitement about who Jesus is and what he is doing and the change he has made in their lives. And they begin sharing their faith. So when Jesus is coming close to Jericho, these early believers start telling their neighbors and their friends and their family members, they start saying, here he comes, here he comes. This is the guy we've been telling you about. You can't miss it. And so all of Jericho comes to see Jesus, but all the excitement, all the rush, all the crowd is because this early group of believers has been sharing and is excitedly inviting everyone to come see Jesus. As I think about just that part of the story, and think about the church today, are we doing that? Are we so excited about who Jesus is? Are we so excited about the change he has made in our lives? Are we so excited about his presence in our church and what we are learning from him and how he is calling us to action? Are we so excited about that that we are sharing that with our friends and our family members, our neighbors and our coworkers, the people who work at the grocery store or the gas station? So I think about the background to this text. It reminded me that in the year 2001, I began the process of church planting. And in that, I was shocked by how many people reported not being invited to church, nor even hearing about Christians sharing their faith. So in 2001, as I was studying church planting, as I was studying faith in our country and seeing how many people were no longer going to church and how many people weren't being reached, my heart was stirred. I couldn't help but think that we had to do something, and that really was a catalyst for me in going and starting a church in a very large unchurched area. But do you know what's true 20 years ago and it's present today was if 20 years ago, it was very clear to us that if the church did not start becoming this contagious force for Jesus, if the church did not start becoming this invitational force, that our nation would continue to accelerate into a post-Christian nation. Now that happened 8 years ago that we became post-Christian, and it has continued to this day. To this day, our nation now is a point where most children, if a teacher asked them on Monday, what did you do this weekend? If one of those children were to say, I went to church, and then if the child was looking at his or her classroom and say, well, how many of you went to church? It would be a minority of students. 4 out of 25 students would have gone to church that weekend. And so that's why I love this text about Jericho, because it reminds us that what makes this mass event possible are those early Christians' excitement and their invitations. They want to reach out. They want to make sure that people come and see Jesus, that they experience Jesus. You might remember that a few years ago, I shared about a friend of mine who is in Kansas City, Missouri, planting a church there. And one of the ways that he reached out to others was a very simple act, but every day he would put 20 pennies in his pocket, and maybe more than that. And he put the pennies in his pocket to start his day, and then he would go into Kansas City. And every time he would talk to someone about Jesus or invite them to the church or reach out to them, he would take a penny from his right-hand pocket and transfer to his left-hand pocket. And he would never leave an area, and he would not stop his day until his right pocket was empty, because he had known that he had reached out to that many people. And he did that for quite some time. That was one of his ways of reaching out to others and starting that church. This text is inviting us as a missional church into this exciting adventure of making sure that we are inviting people to come and experience Jesus. Next, what we notice about this story is the account of Zacchaeus' reality. There's no room for him. This reminds me, my family and I, when we lived downstate, we made it a tradition to go to the Detroit Thanksgiving Day Parade. And so me and another buddy of mine, we would get up at 4:30 in the morning, and then we would meet at a house at 5 in the morning, and we would drive down to Detroit. We got there while it was still dark, and it was always brutally cold. And we would go to our spot, and we would put our chairs there, and we would mark it off. And the reason that we did this was because if you didn't get there at 6 o'clock, 6:30 in the morning, you wouldn't get that prime spot. There wouldn't be room, and we wanted our kids to be right there on the street. We wanted our kids to see everything. And so we did this. And, you know, if you came down to the Thanksgiving Day Parade at 8:30 or 9 o'clock, there was no way you were getting that close. You were going to be 2-3 rows back. But we wanted that exposure. As you see the story, Zacchaeus, yes, he's short, but he can't get to the street. And he's a wealthy tax collector, and no one's going to let him have their spot. And so what we see very early on is there's a reality for Zacchaeus in the story. And the reality for him is that there's no room. You know, as Jesus is walking down the street, and it's crowded, it is packed, you can't help but see Zacchaeus in a sycamore fig tree. And Zacchaeus would have been alone in that tree and probably not many people around that tree. And Jesus' heart would have been inclined towards Zacchaeus because Jesus would have realized there's no room for him here. And I can't help but think of that truth. No room. How that was always a part of Jesus' heart. How it trained his eyes to see people who are given the message, there's no room for you here. This expression, no room. It was part of Jesus' birth story. Growing up, Jesus would have said to Mary, Joseph, now, tell me again, why was I born in a stable? None of my friends were born in a stable. None of my cousins were born in a stable. I don't know anybody else who was born in a stable. And I know you keep telling me it's special and I should feel special because I was born in a stable, but why again was I born in a stable? And Mary and Joseph would have recounted that story to him many times, probably going to Bethlehem and being told repeatedly, there's no room. And what we see in this story is that Jesus wants everyone to have a place. Jesus doesn't want anyone to be left out. Jesus wants for everyone to know there is always room for you. This is very important for a missional church family, that our hearts and our eyes are attuned and sensitive, and that we could see the reality that many people in our world today have received that message in one form or another. There's no room. Some people in our community believe that there's no room in the church for them. And so this is really important for us, is that we understand that we have a heart for those people and that we live out Jesus' sincere invitation to everyone to always say, there is always room for you in Christ's church. Another detail that we notice in the story is that Zacchaeus is wealthy. Now, this is very important for us to take note of because often we have this misperception that Jesus only cared for and reached out to the poor. Many of us were raised to believe this. Many of us still believe this. But why this story is so important is that we will see this in the Gospels repeatedly. Yes, Jesus reaches out to the poor, of course. And the poor identify with Jesus, and Jesus identifies with the poor. But throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus reaching out to the wealthy. We see him reaching out to people who have power. And guess what? They connect to Jesus. Jesus connects with them. And when Jesus went to Zacchaeus that day, the crowd was aghast, not only because Zacchaeus was a sinner, but the reason that they said Zacchaeus was a sinner is because he was wealthy. He had accumulated his money through unethical means, but they were basically saying he's wealthy. And that group and that crowd had a severe distaste for wealthy people. That crowd didn't connect with wealthy people, and wealthy people probably didn't connect with that crowd. There was a huge gap between these two types of people, the poor and the wealthy. And Jesus, in his ministry, in being missional, in reaching out, he does everything he could possibly do to bridge the gap. And the way he bridges the gap between two opposing forces is he says that being a follower of Jesus, being like him, it is our mission to reach out to every person, despite their wealth or lack of. No matter what Jesus says to us, you're not just supposed to reach out to the poor. You're supposed to reach out to the middle class. You're supposed to reach out even to those who might be the most difficult, the wealthy. Jesus calls us as a missional church family to practice this. He says, reach out to all people. Bridge the divides. Don't exasperate them. You know, as we think about this text today, and there's so many more lessons that we could learn from it, but the premise of the story is that Jesus is setting an example. He wants the crowd, he wants the hundreds, if not thousands, of people. And reaching out to Zacchaeus, he wants to set an example. He knows the power of his example. He knows that the one thing they will never forget that day is what he did. And Jesus wants the same for us. He is missional, he wants us to be missional in following his example. Now, when Jesus forms the disciples around him, the 12, and when they become his team and they travel with him day and night and they travel with him from one town to the next, Jesus wants to make sure that not only do they follow his example in doing that, but then Jesus challenges them to follow his example. It's in the book of Luke, chapter 9, verses 1 through 6, where we see this come into play. When Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. He told them, take nothing for the journey, no staff, no bag, no bread, no money, no extra shirt, and whatever house you enter, stay there until you leave that town. If people do not welcome you, leave their town and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. So they set out and went from village to village, proclaiming the good news and healing people everywhere. You see, what Jesus does with the disciples is what he is doing with us today as a church. And he is telling us that to be missional, we must be outward focused, not inward. And we have been talking about this intensely for the last 2 years, that a missional church family looks outwards, that those who are outside of its walls are immensely important to them. Even more important than those who are inside. And so as Jesus sends the disciples out, there's literally that word that says everywhere. That means Jesus tells them there's no boundaries, there's no limits, there's no place that's out of bounds. You go wherever. You go to Samaria, that forbidden land. Go there. I'm telling you guys to go everywhere. And we see the disciples go and do that. And so Jesus is calling us as Christians. He's calling us as church. Same thing. He's saying to us, go everywhere, sharing the good news. So some key questions to us for us today from this text: are we? Are we going everywhere? Who are we not reaching? Possibly, why are we not reaching out to them? And what can we do to reach out to them? These are outward-oriented questions that a missional church is always asking itself because it so cares about being true and living into the challenge that Jesus is giving his church today. As you think about that last word from that last text that we just read, everywhere, this is a great introduction into what is called the Great Commission, given by Jesus in Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20. And here's the scripture. Thinking about that Great Commission, for 26 years, our church's ministry of message and music has been committed. That's why we started to reaching out beyond our walls to share the good news with our community and beyond. And you think about this message and music ministry, and it's such a wonderful example for us as a church that we always need to be thinking about how can we take and share God's good news outside of our walls and into our communities. You think about this Great Commission that calls us to go everywhere. You can't help but think about last fall when a group of our adults went on a mission trip to Guatemala. And there in Guatemala, not only did they instruct villagers on how to use water filters, but they shared the gospel. And over 40 people came to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior because we had a group of adults who were committed to living out the Great Commission and going wherever God wanted them to go. This is who we are as a missional church family. This is what we want for our future. We want to be a church of believers. We're going everywhere because we're excited about Jesus. And we want to invite people into Jesus. And we want people to experience what Jesus is doing. You know, about probably 10 years ago, I read an incredible book that is one of my favorites. It's by Erwin McManus. It's called An Unstoppable Force. It talks about the church. And I love his statement in there. It says, the church is on mission. Every disciple is a missionary. And if there's anything that you're to get from this message today, it's that's what Jesus is asking of you. He's asking of you, be a missionary. Reach out to all people and go wherever he leads you. If our community, our nation, and world ever needed a missional church family that reaches out, it is now. So, dear Father, we come to you in prayer today and we ask that our hearts will have been spoken to, that your Holy Spirit will move our hearts, will awaken our hearts, and will stir our hearts to be a church family that becomes an unstoppable force because we are living out Jesus' calling to be missionaries in our world today. In your name, amen. And today, as you think about the lesson that we just received from Scripture, it is so important that we remember that we can only do what Jesus has called us to do when he is in us. I love that scripture from Philippians says, I can do all things in and through Christ who strengthens me. And this morning, as we come to receive communion, this sacrament of juice and bread, it is literally Christ's instruction. And he says in these sacraments, he said, make it personal. Understand that I am present. Know that I am with you. Know that the juice, which is my blood, which was shed for you, it will strengthen you. The bread, which represents my body, which was broken for you, it will fortify you. And so this morning, I invite you, if you have your juice in your bread or what other elements might represent communion for you this morning, I invite you to receive communion from Christ this morning as that necessary gift of his presence being poured into us so that we may live out his calling for our lives. And that as a missional church family in receiving Christ, we will have the strength that we need to be who he has called us to be. So at this time, you take your bread, may you do so knowing that this is Christ's gift to you. Take it in remembrance of him. And as you have the juice, which is his blood shed for you, take it. And knowing that he is present, he is with you, and he is in you. Amen. So, dear Father, we just take a moment of silence to appreciate the experience of receiving these sacraments. Dear Jesus, we just take a moment. Thank you for your love and your sacrifice for us. And we pray that our faithful response And doing so will be love, sacrifice for you and for others. In your name, amen. Well, after the service this morning, I'm going to invite you to go to our website and to tune in to Pastor Ben's Anchor Kids Experience. And they have just been doing an incredible series, The Wild West. And so you don't want to miss that. And then, of course, on Sunday night and Wednesday night, Pastor Ben is with our youth, and those meetings continue. And so please encourage your youth to participate in those experiences as well. And then this week, I want to remind you that the commitment cards that were either emailed to you or mailed to you, we are praying and we are so excited, and we look forward to you returning those commitment cards so we can see what we're going to be able to accomplish as a missional church family this year. So thank you. And we will continue to have a forward by faith spirit. So at this time, please receive the benediction. And again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And Jesus says the same to us this morning. "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." Amen.